Hello and welcome back to Chasing Excellence, a show about chasing what truly matters. My name is Patrick Cummings. As always, I'm here with Ben Bergeron. Thank you so much for joining us. How are you, Ben?
Doing good, Patrick. We're in the midst of fall. We have our first 30-degree day, and we don't have heat in the building.
Is there a day that you turn on the heat in there?
Or is it's the day that it gets cold. And yesterday was that day, and yesterday it did not work.
Yep.
Which is strange, actually. We turned it on a day earlier, and it did work. We started making fires, too, at home, which is awesome.
Oh, yeah. That is really fun. I like that a lot.
So good.
All right. We're talking about parenting today. The U.S. Surgeon General's Advisory on the Mental Health and Well-Being of Parents. This is a document that this U.S. Surgeon General Vivek Murthy co-authored. He's the Surgeon General, so his name's on it. But I think a lot of people had a hand in writing it. And it focuses on mental health and well-being of parents and caregivers in America. It highlights the stressors parents face, the impact of parental mental health, which is hard to say.
That's hard. You did a good job with that.
And provides some recommendations for various sectors to support parents. I want to talk about this. We're going to dive into a whole bunch of things that I was thinking about in reading this or after reading this. I just want to give one quick quote as to why I think this is really important and why it's interesting for us to talk about. And this is from the advisory. It's a quote. The work of parenting is essential not only for the health of children, but also for the health of society. Additionally, we know the well-being of parents and caregivers is directly linked to the well-being of their children. The stressors parents and caregivers have today are being passed to children in direct and indirect ways, impacting families and communities across America. So we're going to use this advisory as a jumping off point, a launching pad for the kinds of conversations that we often have, but using this advisory to sort of guide us a little bit. Before we jump into that, chasingexcellence.email, get on the free newsletter list. We send out an email on the weekends with a link to a form. You can submit as many questions as you'd like that we can try to get into future episodes. We also just announced our next two book clubs. We're going to try to squeeze two books in before the end of the year. We're going to read Build the Life You Want by Arthur Brooks and Oprah Winfrey. Then we're going to read 4,000 Weeks by Oliver Berkman, which I know is a book we've talked about before and both you and I highly regard. So we're going to keep those two book clubs exclusive to the Chase Club book club. So while you are at chasingexcellence.email, consider upgrading into the Chase Club. It's our premium membership. You get ad-free episodes as well as things like the book club. Link to those are in the show notes. All right. This conversation, I want to just give one little bit of data as to why I think this is an important conversation to have. This is from the advisory. 41% of parents say that most days they are so stressed they cannot function, and 48% say that most days their stress is completely overwhelming compared to other adults. And the other adults were 20% and 26% respectively. So something's going on with parents. Mm. I think as parents, we can at least appreciate the stress and the pressure that comes along with being a parent. We're not going to talk too much about the document itself. If I've got an appropriate quote or stat or something, I'll pull it back. I will link to the document in the show notes as well if folks do want to read it. I thought I think I can pull out three different places where we can have a conversation. And I want to first couch it in an analogy, if that's the right word for it, or metaphor. And it's the difference between organic stress and processed stress. And this is something we've talked about before briefly, and it's not a perfect metaphor, but I started thinking about it again when reading this document, where in the realm of parenting, organic stress is the stress that just comes with the job, right? It's the sleeplessness. It's the worry about their future. It's the time demands. Like, it's all the things that you get when signing up to be a parent. And then there's the process stress, what we could kind of call or consider the process stress. And that to a large degree is just the stuff that we invite in, or we invite in to a larger degree than perhaps we need to. And so I want to leave the organic stress aside to a degree, because again, it just kind of comes with the territory. And I want to talk mostly about process stress. In the document, there were three things that I pulled out in relation to this idea of process stress. And it's social comparison, it's attention hijacking, and it's a comfort bias. And so I just want to kind of talk through with you, Ben, like each one of those things, again, where it pops up in the advisory, but also just where it pops up in our own experience. And so I want to start with social comparison. And this is from the document, a quote: societal expectations, norms, and pressures to meet perceived parenting standards can contribute to stress as well. As technological and economic forces have reshaped the world at a rapid pace, parents may find it more difficult to prepare children for a future that is harder to anticipate. And another one, many parents also struggle with a modern practice of time-intensive parenting and contemporary expectations around childhood achievement that tells them if they are not doing more and more for their children in the escalating race for success, they will fail as parents. And so maybe let's just jump off with that last quote. I'd love your thoughts.
So first off, maybe before we get back to that, this job of parenting, you'd be hard pressed to find a more important job that you have as much influence. But has there ever been a role or job with less of a job description, less of a handbook, an operations manual? And I think that conundrum of the amazing, awesome responsibility of essentially potentially what it could mean to have a meaningful life, yet it's like, go get it, Tiger. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. Have a good one. And I share this because I think this is the heart of the stress. Mm-hmm. I think this is where it actually, the magnitude of the responsibility and the void of direction on how to get there. Mm-hmm. And when you see what seems like other people thriving at it, comparison becomes the thief of all joy. We get stressed out that we're not where either we believe other people are or we believe where we should be. Mm-hmm. And Benjamin Hardy and Dan Sullivan have written mm-hmm. about this in called The Gap and the Gain. They talk about in terms of entrepreneurship where most entrepreneurs live in the gap, which is where I am versus where I believe I should be. And because of that, they have anger, frustration. They are constantly not measuring up. They have very little fulfillment. They don't enjoy the process. It's a constant battle, as opposed to what they call living the gain. Mm-hmm. About like, you can have these goals, you can have these aspirations, but look at what you have right now. It's not just gratitude. It's a matter of truly seeing how far you've come and really living in this moment for what it is, still with great aspirations and great goals. But this moment is an amazing moment for you, especially if you look back on where you've come from. And the contention is if you live more in the gain, you have a lot more appreciation, you have a lot more enjoyment, and the stress goes away. If you want to get in a flow state as a parent, as an entrepreneur, as an athlete, if you want to get into a flow state, you can't be in a state of judgment. Judgment pulls you out of that thing. So when you have that, damn, I missed that shot. Oh, I'm going to come in last place. They're better than me. All of those things will pull you out of a flow state from an athletic perspective. Well, it's the same thing with being a business owner. My team isn't following through on their roles and responsibilities. We don't have the same revenue, market share, or customer acquisition we were supposed to have this quarter. We don't. We're missing. Stress. As opposed to, wow, compared to a year ago, even if you're not in a better position, man, we have learned a lot. I've grown a lot as a leader. Our team has really, like, there's so much to look at. Same thing with athletes, same thing with parents. If we want to work on stress mitigation, I think the first thing we need to do is get rid of that comparison, looking over the fence and going, the grass is greener over there. The grass is greener where you water it. We all know that. Realizing that it's just a matter of us. It's almost cliche how much I say this at this point, but it's one of my favorite. We're going to put it on the walls of my gym because I need it more. Everyone needs it more. It's doing what you can with what you got for where you are. You're not supposed to be able to do more than that. I saw this really cool graphic the other day, which was what we want to happen. It's this series of about 12 boxes that all say 100%, and every box is checked. And it says what actually happens. And it's a box that says like 68% and it's checked, and a box that says 23% and it's checked. And it's a box that says 83%, and it's checked, 98%, and so on. The gains happen when you accept the second one. Mm-hmm. If you don't accept the second one, that is reality. You're not supposed to be able to do 100%. Perfection is the enemy of execution. Then we're going to be completely stressed out. It's probably why with today's connection economy, we see more. We used to just see our friends, the people within a couple mile radius of you, the people that went to your schools is essentially it.
Yep.
Maybe your brother and sister who live in the next town over and next state over, and you see them on holidays. But that was the extent of our comparison. Now you see the highlight reels, which are not real. The other part of comparison, which I think is really important, which we talked about before, is no one compares holistically.
Mm-hmm.
People compare against the excellence of a single modality, and they will only compare against the top performers in that modality. I want that guy's body. I want that guy's earning potential. I want that guy's freedom and vacations. I want that guy's public speaking ability. I want that guy's stress level. And it's never like the one sig. That's not the way we do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an inherent thing in us as human beings, but something that we have to realize that we have a bias towards and then work to override it because it doesn't serve us at all.
How did you, when you were working with the high level athletes, and I'm thinking about the judgment specifically, how do you start to put into practice the catching yourself when you're judging yourself and replacing that with something else?
You know what's really interesting? You say, how did we start that? We actually went the other way. We started with that, and then we lost it.
Mm.
I started very much with the Nick Saban approach of the process, which is, this is just about executing this one play, this one rep, this one workout as best as we can for where we are right now. The ultimate thing that really matters is your competitiveness, your drive, your willingness to work hard. The results are ultimately outside of our control, and I'm not really that concerned about it. When we started this process, that's what I talked about all the time. That's what I did all the time. I never asked for workout scores.
Mm-hmm.
It was never, what'd you back squat today? It was never, how much did you clean and jerk? It was never, how fast did you do that workout? How many reps did you get? It was just like, tell me about your workout. I want to learn about the story you're telling yourself.
Mm-hmm.
After Capture won the games the second time, we implemented all these goals. Goals create so much judgment in the moment. How far, how close am I to that goal? Am I moving forward? Am I moving backward? Am I moving forward at a pace that I expected to? You could even be making gains, but you don't think it's fast enough. If the goals are based off of the way that you compete, meaning your effort level, which is completely inside of your control, let's talk about those goals. We have goals. And the goal is to do the very best that we can in this given moment, given where we are. It's a subtle but drastic paradigm shift in the way you approach the totality of a career. I can't overemphasize enough how free she was able to compete because there were no expectations.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's not to say they don't serve a purpose. For certain individuals, they can be beneficial. You know, a 4-minute mile and a 2-hour marathon probably would not happen without those goals. So they do serve for purposes. Getting a man on the moon, like, they do serve their purposes, but you have to also recognize when they're not.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, what we're talking about in terms of the goals of keeping up with the Joneses, keeping up with the other parents that are doing all of these things, and just recognizes that's a simple thing. Is this serving me or not? And when it's not, have the bravery, have the awareness to let them go and focus on things inside your control.
Right. And recognize that much of the expectations we put either externally or the expectations we have for ourselves, they're often arbitrary and made up, and there's no evidence that they're the right things. And so I think there's a lot of times when we are comparing ourselves to others, we're comparing ourselves based on a very fuzzy sense of what matters. And the fact that it's so fuzzy, or the fact that there are so many things that are so fuzzy, you can't help but be in a state of stress or anxiety that you're not moving towards a finish line or a goal line that you can't actually define, that you can't actually articulate, and therefore can't tell if you are moving closer to it or just moving in circles.
You know, I love what you said. There's like arbitrary, fuzzy. It's hard to tell if they actually are the right things or they are the things that matter. In terms of parenting, you know, the things that are not fuzzy and actually do matter, you not being stressed out around your kids. Like that's like, and we're putting in these arbitrary things that are pulling us away from the things that actually matter. You know, I go back to that, like if there was a guidebook for this thing, if we were more schooled on this, I cannot imagine a scenario where creating a relaxed, loving, and caring home environment is not massively beneficial. And the opposite just has to be, I don't want to say detrimental, but not helpful. Like
not optimal.
Not optimal, right? It's like, can you, and this isn't just for kids, right? This is you as a human being. Like, can you create a more calm, stress-free environment? We talk about stress here a lot in terms of what it does physiologically, not just emotionally and psychologically, but what it actually does to the body. We're talking about, as you kind of alluded to, two different types of stress. We're talking about the chronic stress, not the hormesis, not the beneficial stress to the body.
Absolutely. All right. Let's take a quick break, say thanks to a few sponsors. Then we've got two more of these bullet points I want to talk about. We're brought to you this time around by Lumen. If you're looking to take control of your health, I've got something revolutionary for you. It's called Lumen, the world's first handheld metabolic coach. Head to lumen.me/excellence to learn more about how you can begin measuring your health through your breath. Here's how it works. Simply breathe into it in the morning, and it will tell you if you're burning fats or carbs. What sets Lumen apart is its ability to give you personalized nutrition plans based on your metabolism. You can also use it before and after workouts and meals to get real-time insights into what your body is doing. Metabolic health is crucial. Your metabolism is your body's engine. With Lumen, you get recommendations to improve your metabolic health, which can lead to easier weight management, improved energy levels, and better sleep, among other benefits. Your metabolism can be improved just like your body gets stronger and fitter from working out. So if you're ready to step up your health game, go to lumen.me/excellence and get 15% off your Lumen. That's lumen.me/excellence for 15% off your purchase. We're also brought to you this time around by Element. If you're looking to up your hydration game, check out Element. Go to drinkelement.com/excellence to get your hands on the electrolyte. Ben always holds this up as I say this. Get your hands on the electrolyte mix you've been hearing us talk about for more than a year. Element is not your average sports drink. It's a zero sugar electrolyte mix that delivers a powerful punch of sodium, potassium, and magnesium. It's perfect for athletes, keto followers, and anyone in need of a hydration boost without all that extra sugar. Just mix a packet with water and you're good to go. Olympic athletes to weekend warriors all love Element. When you order through the link I just gave you, you'll get a free Element sample pack with your purchase. Experience the difference yourself, risk-free. If you're not satisfied, pass it on to a friend and get your money back. No questions asked. Stay salty and hydrated. Go to drinkelement.com/excellence to get some for yourself and grab that free sample pack with your order. All right, so we talked about social comparison. The second thing that popped out at me is something we've talked about recently, and that is attention hijacking. We had a whole episode, I think we called it Own Your Attention, where we talked about the attention merchants and how they are effectively built to incentivize addiction. From the advisory, quick quote, nearly 70% of parents say parenting is now more difficult than it was 20 years ago, with children's use of technology and social media as the top two cited reason. Jonathan Haidt, who wrote a book called The Anxious Generation that came out recently, I just happened to see this on Instagram. He put up a chart or graph. The info is cited from U.S. National Survey on Drug Use and Health. And major depression among teenagers since 2010 has increased 145% in girls and 161% in boys. And so, of course, we've talked about this before. The average American spends 8 to 9 hours a day consuming media. When it comes to this conversation about stress, specifically stress, what we have to give up when we give in to 6, 7, 8, 9 hours of screen-based attention. And this is for us, but this is also for kids. So what do we give up? We give up time in nature. We give up walking. We give up cooking our own meals. We give up, of course, exercise. We give up sleep. We give up good conversations. We give up reading books. We give up play. And I started putting that list together just because it's easy to do. But then I started thinking about, well, everything I just put on that list are the exact things that you would want if you were stressed out and you were looking to reduce your stress. We're giving up these natural medicines that we could take, and we're choosing something else, and that something else is making us more stress. And because we're choosing that thing, we can't do the thing that's actually going to remedy the stress in and of itself.
So this obviously fires both of us up.
Yep.
Somebody recently said to me, the day you give your kid access to a smartphone is the day you end their childhood. Mm. If we're talking about parenting, here's what's crazy. It's not always what it seems at the moment, right? Like, hard things are hard in the moment, but they'll benefit you later on. My 24-year-old was just saying the other day, she was saying, it's different between wants and likes, which is good. She's like, I want to stay in bed in the morning, but I like the way I feel when I get up and have a really productive morning. I want to go home and watch Netflix, but I like the feeling I have when I go to the gym and I get a workout. I want ice cream, but I like the feeling. You get it, right?
Yep.
I want some peace and quiet from my kids, so I'm going to give them an iPad. But I really like it when my kids are not depressed, not anxious, not socially inept, and can be emotionally mature enough to deal with hard things on their own. And all those things that you just listed, from being out in nature, play, eating good food, sleep, like, those are, as you said, which I love the words, is like, those are all like little bits of medicine against this. Mm-hmm. It's just that it's really hard in the moments. This is like this, but this is hard things 101 of, we got to resist the temptation in the short term. And my wife, Heather's so good at this. I learned so much about this. This happened last night. Kid comes in at 3:30 in the morning, says, can I come and snuggle with you? You're so tired. You don't want the fight. The easiest thing to do is go, yep, come on in. It actually feels good for a little bit. Mm-hmm. But then you do that the second night and the third night, and now you have a habit where your kid is coming in and doing that, and now you have this really hard, like, every night your sleep's getting disrupted because dot, 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 dot. Yep. The hard thing to do in that moment is deal with it in that moment. And whether it's screen times, video games, them not wanting to go do chores, not doing their homework, it's so much easier to give in the moment, but that's not doing ourselves any good in the long run. And this is the, you know, that again, that conundrum. It's really hard to say no to the screens, because in that moment, it does give you reprieve and it does lower your stress. But over the long run, you end up with anxious and depressed kids based off of the stats you just said, 140 to 160% more likely. Well, then in that case, we got to not only say no to the screens. You can't just do that. Now you have to do the really hard things. No, you can't use your iPad during the week. So when your kid is bored and they don't have friends to play with because they're all on screens, you got to go in the backyard and build a fort with your six-year-old. You need to pull out the sewing machine and make a dress with your eight-year-old. You need to teach your kid how to play chess. These are things that in the moment create shorter time span. They put more on your plate, but in the long run pay off so much. So does everything else that we talk about on this podcast. Mm-hmm. Do the hard but necessary things to have a great, meaningful life. Last night, it was raining. Bodhi is really into soccer right now. The last thing I want to do at 6:30 night in the dark after dinner is go out and play soccer in the rain.
Yep.
But we put the hoods on. I sat in goal in the dark and he belted shots at me and I'm just dodging shots. Every now and then it would hit me like rail me in the thigh and like yell out a scream. I'm just like essentially like a target practice. But he loves it and he's outside and doing the thing. Like I want my kid to be active and be able to play on the soccer field. And that didn't just happen. We stopped using screens. So now when he's bored, that's what he goes out and does. It certainly helps if the parents get involved. And Heather did the same thing. Heather put on her rain boots and put on her raincoat, and she was out there before dinner, and I was out after dinner. Mm-hmm. I think it's just a willingness to not default to easy. Because, man, it would have been so much easier if he's asking, will you please go out with me and play soccer in the backyard, to go, you know what, actually tonight – you can go on your iPad, because I just don't want to do that so badly.
Two things. The first is I'm going to send my boys to your house because they would happily go out to the backyard. Weather,
yeah, right?
Doesn't
yeah.
matter. And they will play with Bodhi because they would love that.
Come on down.
And the second thing is it's just worth pointing out the mindset you just described, the mindset that I think we would both ascribe to or try to ascribe to, is also much more time intensive, to your
point. Totally. It takes more time, more effort.
And part of the stress and part of the, you know, in the advisory, part of the stress was just this ridiculous lack of time that everybody feels. We just don't have time for all of the things. Because parenting has, in the last 20 years, and I think this is actually a big part of what that quote or that stat was, parenting is quite a bit more intensive than it was even to our parents and certainly to our grandparents. Both of my parents come from families of 8 or 9 kids. Like it's impossible for them to have parented to the intense degree that we do. And so I do think it's worth pointing out that doing the difficult thing, doing the thing you like versus the thing you want, also brings with it a certain kind of stress or another kind of stress.
It's a short term and it's immediate now.
Yep.
Right? It's not the long term. It's not my kid. It's not depression. It's not addiction. It's not anxiety. So that's what it is, another level of stress. Just like I want to be healthy. It's another level of stress to have to get up and go to the gym. It's a level of stress to have to cook a home-cooked meal as opposed to go grabbing fast food. It's another level of stress to go and like, hey, I want to sit down and veg out in front of Netflix. No, I'm going to go to bed early and try to arrange my whole entire evening schedule to make sure that can happen. Mm. The idea of us being overbooked, maybe even over-involved, is a big part as well. You know, like the commercial, you might have missed it, but there's a commercial when I was a kid that used to come on during the 10 o'clock news that said, it's 10 o'clock. Do you know where your kids are?
Yeah.
It's like, that's how uninvolved our parents were at 10 o'clock at night. It was like, oh yeah, where are our 10-year-olds? It's been hours and it's 10 o'clock. We should find them. There had to be a commercial to go on and remind people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's interesting about that is it actually feeds into this idea of attention hijacking as well, because I think 20 years ago, what was going on 20 years ago, suddenly we got more news. 24 hours of news started around then. And so what you saw was the things that the news prioritizes, which are flashy and scary and make you pay attention over the commercial break. And so those ads are a really good example of scaring parents into believing that the world is a dangerously scary place and that you can't let go of your kids. You can't let your kids go anywhere. And so over time, over the last couple, I think, generations of parenting, is we've become so fearful of letting kids go and be kids and go play and be out of our sight for more than 2 minutes that we then, you know, back to this idea of organic stress and process stress, we create more stress than is necessary by saying, you can't ever leave my sight. And if you can't ever leave my sight and I still need to make dinner, well, here's the TV. We compensate for the fact that we're not allowing freedom with our kids by giving them things simply because it feels safer. It feels safer for them to be near us, even if it means they're on a screen, when that's rarely the case.
Not only safer, but keeping up with the Joneses is the screen then turns into piano lessons and karate lessons and gymnastic and soccer and tutoring. And we're going to get you into this club, this AAU sports team. Every nine-year-old dad thinks that their kid's going to play in the NHL. Right? It's like, and if you don't, it's like, oh, what's wrong with my kid? He's not on the elite travel team. We went through this crazy ebb and flow. Our kids were just getting into sports, like club-level sports. COVID happens, and there's nothing. So we went from just tasting it to zero, as everybody did. We're like, wow, this is really awesome. I think a lot of parents felt that. And then, you know, even backing up a little bit more before that, we were looking at these other parents who are traveling all around. We're like, we'll never do that. We've had this conversation.
Yeah.
And last year, we didn't do it at the extreme level. We weren't traveling to Texas, Minnesota, and the UK to play field hockey games. But we got into it. Bodie had soccer 7 nights a week. Mm-hmm. And Harley was on 2 lacrosse teams. This year, Bodie has soccer 4 nights a week, and Harley's not playing lacrosse at all. Mm-hmm. They also both do CrossFit twice a week. So Bodie was doing CrossFit twice a week and soccer 7 days a week. We went from that to they both do CrossFit twice a week, and Bodie's doing soccer 4 times a week. Harley's doing no other activities.
Mm-hmm.
We're like, this is crazy. Like this schedule is kind of crazy. Now, part of it is just the way the schedule fell. So I'm not going to take the credit for totally engineering that and having the bravery to pull back. He's still on 2 teams. But wow, what a difference in terms of the calmness of this whole thing. Mm-hmm. And we know he's not going to play MLS soccer. And that's okay. We're just doing it because it's a cool activity that he really enjoys.
Yep.
It's that fear, as you said, of not only a dangerous world, but it's also the FOMO, the fear of missing out. My kid's not going to be with the best team. My kid's not going to get the same opportunities. My kid's not going to be able to play in college or in high school, projecting out instead of just being in this moment right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm looking at my nails. I'm doing that. Talking about like doing things that your kids want to do.
Yeah.
I have purple nails on that Harley did last night because Harley wanted to paint my nails. So
nice. So in between getting pegged with a soccer ball, you're...
we went to bed. Perfect timing. Now we're in bed. It's manicure time. She comes with all the stuff.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right, let's move into the third bullet point because I think we've touched on it a little bit, but it's this idea of comfort bias. Obviously, the comfort crisis is still in my head 2 months after reading it. But I do think there is an element inside of the advisory that strikes me. And a lot of what our conversation is, right? Even the idea of doing the hard thing now is in some ways uncomfortable, of course. And I think, you know, like we talked about when we talked about the comfort crisis and the book itself, I think we've become enamored by convenience and comfort. And I think it's very much to our detriment of our overall health, our mental health, our kids' health, et cetera. And in the document, in a 2021 survey, approximately 65% of parents and guardians and 77% of single parents in particular experienced loneliness compared to 55% of non-parents. So it's quite a bit of quite a bit of adults who say that loneliness is a part of their life. The other thing is we need to talk, and this is again another quote, we need to talk openly about the stress and struggles that come with parenting. And both of those things, while different, are related in the sense that it's really comfortable to sit in your house and watch Netflix. It's really uncomfortable sometimes to try to re-engage with a friend who maybe you've lost touch with. It's uncomfortable certainly to say, man, I'm having a really hard time with X. My kid is struggling with this and I don't have any of the answers. All of those things are incredibly uncomfortable. And when you combine that with the comfort economy that we currently exist in, where Netflix is a click away, TikTok is in your pocket, where it is so very easy to hide ourselves in snacks and food that doesn't particularly do us very good, except in the moment, it begins to be a really high ingredient in stress when you have the challenge and then you don't face the challenge, but in fact, you look for the closest Band-Aid and say, I'll deal with the challenge later. Right now, I just want to watch the show, veg out, doom scroll, eat an entire cake.
You know, well, this is like leadership, like 101 type thing, right? It's like, how do you, because it's really the job of a leader. It's just to position everyone to be better at dealing with challenges. And that's like, whether that's accountability, not being distracted, leveling up, learning a new skill, whatever it is, being a better teammate. The easiest thing for a leader to do is just push off till tomorrow. Like, you're a manager of a gym and you find out that two coworkers aren't getting along. What's the easy thing to do? I mean, we're right back to the same one of like, do the hard thing.
Yep.
You just push off till tomorrow.
Hope it fixes itself.
Yeah, hope it fixes itself. And this is, they don't fix themselves. The job of the leader is to remove obstacles for growth. So that's the same thing for you as a parent. It's your job to help your kids grow emotionally, spiritually, physically, ability to handle hard better. The best way to do that is twofold. First is to highlight it. It's the thing that you pay attention to and you reward. Above all else, it's the thing that you're looking for it everywhere, especially when they do it well. You see on the playground, one kid be mean, rude, bully, whatever it is to your kid, and your kid responds in a really appropriate, mature way. Whoa, double, triple, quadruple down on that moment, highlight it, celebrate it. That's an amazing thing. Oh my gosh. Do you realize how cool that was what you just did? So you want to like what gets reward, you'll see more of. But the biggest one, even more so than recognizing and rewarding, is modeling. Like we have to do it ourselves. When we are up against it, if we tune out, if we deflect, if we get angry, if we get frustrated, if we get jealous, if we are emotionally dysregulated, they're not going to hear what you say nearly as much as they're going to see what you do. And the biggest thing that we want to do is model it. We got to show that we are the ones that when hard things happen, because they do, and they're going to happen for everybody, that we handle them in really good, productive ways that we're going to be proud of later.
I'm going to paraphrase something you said at the start of this conversation. I think it's a good place to wrap up, but it's that nothing bad will happen when you figure out ways to lower the stress. When you figure out ways to lower your own personal stress as a parent, when you figure out ways to lower the kid's stress, nothing bad will happen when you figure out ways to lower the overall stress in the house on a daily basis. I think that's the biggest takeaway from reading the advisory and having this conversation, which I appreciate. Nothing bad will come when you figure out ways to lower stress.
Yeah, maybe it's like just to close out, like we've been talking a lot about specifics, you know, get them off screens, model the behavior you want them to see, go and do the things with them, share it, create a support network, talk about it with people, be vulnerable yourself. There's a lot of things that we hit on, but maybe the biggest one to lower stress is just what we talk about in every conversation outside of this one, which is take care of yourself.
Yep.
Your words, which I loved, that is your medicine. That is your creating your resilience. You exercising, getting enough sleep, you working on your time management and executive function and not being overbooked yourself. You getting outside, getting sunlight, you having some space and some time to reflect and do the things that you enjoy. Like without those things, you're always going to be against it. And here's the thing. I can hear people right now going like, easy for you to say. I think the Buddha said it, which is the biggest fault of humanity is not recognizing that we are already free. Like everyone's like, well, when I retire, when I get married, when I earn seven figures, when I am able to take that vacation, when I write that book, we are all, everything we do right now is a choice. That's like, back up a little bit and really look at this, but everything that we're doing is a choice. I've said it a bunch of times on this one. People talk to me on the streets now about it. Like, you are not a tree. People talk to me and say that now. But you are not a tree. If you don't like something that's going on, move and go do something different. Like, you have that choice. Sometimes you're just going to be met with more resistance than other times, whether it's your own self-image, whether it's the responsibilities you currently have, whether it's the expectations from friends and family and coworkers. But we all have that freedom to do the things that will set us on fire. And if we want to live a more stress-free life for us and our kids, it really starts with that self-care aspect. And yep, just like we talked about, it's going to take time. You have that time. I just got to double down this a little bit. I was going for a run. I do Sunday run day. It's such a good clarifying thing. I so badly did not want to run. It was raining again, and I really did not want to run, but I just didn't give myself the choice. I went for a 5.5 mile run, and I didn't give myself the choice. And I was like, why did I just do that? Why did I just put on my shoes, put on my joggers, a big heavy sweatshirt, and then a rain jacket over that, and put on my gloves and my hat and go run with my feet freezing cold in the 40 degree rain? That was weird. Why did I just go do that? And what I realized was I just didn't give myself the choice. And what I mean by that is most people, I think very, very few people listening to this didn't brush their teeth this morning. That's a choice. It's something that we've done because we know how important it is and the feeling you have afterwards if you don't do it. And this is just removing that want versus like. If we are able to do that at a more conscious level, rather than let this amygdala, subconscious, alter ego take over, this is how we get to lowering stress in our lives, especially as parents. With parents, it's just more variables. The more variables you have, the more things you have to juggle, the more things you manage, the more less time you have for other things, and the more stressful it becomes. Like, it's no mystery, right? If you manage an organization with 3 employees, that's gonna be less stressful than managing an organization with 30 employees. If you sell one product, you sell blueberry pie. It's gonna be less stressful than you sell blueberry pie and ice cream. There's going to be more stress with that. So I'm unsurprised that being a parent is more stressful than not. But there's also rewards for working through and with stress. And that's why we keep doing it.